Well, we do in ourselves. But thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. That's right. He took away the stench. Hallelujah. And we're going to talk about that today. If you have your Bibles, and I pray you do, it's a good thing. You know, I think Derek helps us out up here some, for those of you who don't. But this is standard equipment right here. You know, this is just like, you know, when you go to play on a football team, you have your equipment on before you go on the field. Right? I bring my equipment with me when I come to church because I don't want to just be a bench warmer. Amen? Hallelujah. Bench warmers don't ever get in the game. Right? They don't ever have no fun. They don't ever get no glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Turn to Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1, and if you would, stand with me for the reading of God's Word. I don't do this every week because sometimes I got stuff to cover and comments to make. Y'all be standing for a long time. But today we're just going to read the first verses 6 through 9. Okay, Galatians 1, 6 through 9. I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel, which is not another, but there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than that which we have preached to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. And you may be seated. The book of Galatians, Paul went, maybe one of the first letters that the Apostle Paul wrote. He wrote this back to the church that he had established because the Judaizers, or that was Jews, who wanted to add something to the requirements to be saved, had come in and told the Galatians that they had to keep the law of Moses and do all these extra things in order to be really saved. And so we're going to explore that just a little bit today. He says in verse 6, I marvel that you are turning away, or you are so soon removed from him who called you into the grace of Christ. Removed there in the Greek means a deserter or a turncoat. Wow, you've deserted the gospel of grace. That's what we're talking about here. And that's what this message is going to be on. That's why that song was so fitting. They have deserted the gospel of grace unto another gospel. It said, to him that had called you, of course, that's God that called them through Christ, from the grace of Christ. And what we're talking about here, when we're talking about the grace of Christ, is his voluntary self-surrender to humiliation and death, from no other prompting than his own love for sinful men. That's the grace of God. Unto another gospel. It's not really another gospel. There is no other gospel. There's only one gospel. But Paul's making a play on words here. He's like, you've chosen another gospel. Because it wouldn't be another good news. That's what gospel means. But he says it's not really another gospel at all. But it's a pretended revelation from God concerning the way of attaining justification and salvation, a way entirely inconsistent with the very fundamental principles of that doctrine that you were taught. I know that's a mouthful. I'll read it again and try to read it slow. So what he means by another gospel is, it's not really another gospel, but it's a pretended revelation from God, pretended, concerning the way of attaining justification and salvation, a way entirely inconsistent with the very fundamental principles of that doctrine that you were taught. In other words, they had abandoned the doctrine of grace and were being taught a doctrine of works, of the Jewish law, to be specific. After Paul had left, people had come in, crept into the church, and perverted the gospel of Christ. Verse 7, he says that there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. some that trouble you, some that's giving you a hard time, and they're perverting the gospel. The word pervert here means to transmute. Now you've heard the term transmutation. It means to change from one nature, substance, or form, or condition into another. So what they've done here is they've changed this gospel into something that it's not. They've made it something that Paul didn't preach to them in the beginning. And he's saying that if anybody comes to you and preaches a different gospel to you than what I preach, let him be accursed. And the Greek word there is an anathema. It means condemned and damned. But how does that relate to us today here at Thomasville Assembly in our modern day church world? Because that's what I got to do. I got to show you how this connects. We're talking about something that happened a long time ago. But you know what? Solomon said there's nothing new under the sun. I'm going to try this on y'all because it didn't work Wednesday night. Okay. It doesn't mean that jet airplanes have always been, right? When it says there's nothing new under the sun. In fact, I've heard it said that God actually made the first car. It just took us all those years to figure out how to put it together. Wow. I got a different reply Wednesday night. I got stared at like a mule staring at a new gate. And I told them they'd all get it later. But I see some of y'all got it. So very good. Y'all are more alert this morning than on Wednesday night. Praise God. Praise God. Yeah. No, there's nothing new under the sun. People are people. And they have the same attitudes, the same sin, the same devil that's bothering them that they've had from the beginning of time. Nothing changes. How many ever are old enough or maybe have you ever worked in a factory? Boy, yeah. Yeah. I know Todd knows exactly what I'm talking about. You meet the same people everywhere you go to work. They just have a different face and name. They're the same people. I remember working in Lexington down here at Styrex Industries back in the 80s. I can't remember her name. Some crusty old lady. And she's into everything. And And she was always making trouble. She's always, you know, gossiping. And, okay, I went to work. And this is in the 80s. This is in the 90s. I was working at Furlan Mold Company in Kernersville. She was there. Her name was Eula there. She had a different name, a different face, but the same crusty old lady. You know? And there's this same deal with people and attitudes you deal with. They're the same everywhere. They just got a different package, but to the same thing. Nothing new under the sun. So what I'm saying is that these Judaizers that were coming into the church saying you got to keep the Jewish law to be saved, they're still around. They're just packaging this thing differently. And the problem is that they're in our church and they are running the church. And this is something that I have dealt with since I got saved and started going after the gospel of God and have been learning and have been working on for many years to come to the place that I'm at right now. And our biggest problem with this is the Pentecostal church. They're the ones who I believe are preaching a Pharisaical doctrine. They're modern day Pharisees. Does anybody know what a Pharisee is? If you read your Bible, you'll find out that it was the religious folk that were running the church in the day of Jesus, or one of the sects. There was the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the Essenes. Okay? But we have modern day Pharisees. See, a Pharisee is a member of an ancient Jewish sect distinguished by strict observance of the traditional and written law. Notice that strict observance. And commonly held to have pretensions to superior sanctity. You ever met somebody like that? They're all strict about keeping all the rules. And when you talk to them, you believe that they're keeping all the rules. Used to have a pastor. He would never admit he was wrong. He would never admit he had sin or problems in his life. Do you know what that does to people sitting in the congregation? It makes them think, why can't I attain to this? Why can't I get where he's at? You know, something's wrong with me. Something's wrong with my relationship. There wasn't nothing wrong with me. There wasn't nothing wrong with my relationship. There was something wrong with him because he portrayed himself to be holier than the rest of us when in fact he was just like all the rest of us. And that's not bad. But obviously he thought so. So it's a member of a sect, an ancient sect, that held strictly to laws and traditions and pretensions to have superior sanctity. Or it can also be defined as a self-righteous person or a hypocrite, a Pharisee. That's what they mean when you call it. Turn with me to, you might want to keep your finger there in the Galatians, but turn with me back to Matthew 23. I want to show you something. Matthew 23, let's go 1 through 4. Then Jesus spoke to the multitudes and to his disciples, saying, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do, but do not do according to their works, for they say and do not do. For they bind heavy burdens hard to bear and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers." The church is guilty of binding heavy burdens and putting them on the sheep's shoulders that they can't bear, neither could they bear, and in insisting that you keep it. And that if you don't, you're bound for hell. We're going to talk about that a little bit more. See, Pharisees like to tell you how to live. They are quick to tell you how to live with a condescending attitude. Amen? How many ever had somebody tell you how to live? Now, it's my job this morning to stand up here from this book and tell you what the Word says. But it's not my job to come down to your house and sit down and say, "Okay, Todd, you need to do this, you need to do that, you ain't doing this right." That's not my job. That's the Holy Spirit's job. If he wants to know something and wants to ask me about it, and we can talk about it, that's another thing. And I hope you don't mind me using you for an example, Todd. But for me to go to his house and start laying it out for him how he's supposed to live is not my job. So they like to tell you how to live. They like to point out your faults in your life. They like to find out where you're not making the grade so they can show you, because they've already arrived, they can help you. With this same condescending attitude. Okay, they like to make it hard for people to enter the kingdom of God. They like to make it difficult. They like to say, "No, unless you do this, this, and this, you're not going to get in the kingdom of heaven. And if you do this, this, or this, you're going to go to hell." I got three, I actually have four children. Y'all probably didn't know I was old enough for that, did you? Yeah. Gray beard gives it away, don't it? Yeah, I got four children. My three girls, they come up, and I'm not going to say what I was going to say. They come up in church under some teaching that I didn't even know was going on in missionettes and in Sunday school. And the teaching was to them that everything they do sends them to hell. What good is it to be born again if everything I do that might be contrary to what somebody else thinks is right sends me to hell? They don't go to church today. I don't know if it has anything to do with that or not. I wonder about it. You see, there are two kinds of Pharisees. Those who are under constant condemnation because they don't feel like they're doing enough. You ever met somebody like that? Maybe that's you. Maybe you don't feel like you're doing enough, and what you feel like is the conviction of the Holy Spirit to do more so that you can please God And you can appease his wrath is not the Holy Spirit at all, but it's the enemy condemning you and keeping you from having joy in your life. That's a good, we had 8 signs of a legalistic spirit, a handout. I meant to bring a couple more copies today because I wanted to give James one. I guess because he wasn't there Wednesday, I'll get you one Wednesday night, James. And that's what one of the signs was, your joy. You ever met somebody that's saved, but they look like they've been sucking on lemons? Uh-huh. You want some of what I got? No, I don't think so. I don't think I want none of that. Yeah. Uh-huh. Absence of joy. Because you can't have joy when you're under condemnation because you know that you can't do what you're supposed to be doing and you're not doing it right. And it's a continual, everyday thing. And it's a struggle to make it. So there are those that walk under constant condemnation because they don't think they're doing enough. And these are leaders here lots of times. And there are those who are deceived into believing that they're living above sin. Or they're on a higher righteous plane than other Christians. They think they're keeping the law. They're deceived. And I'm going to show you close to the end of this message where they're deceived. Okay? So hang on. And don't throw rocks at me because we're going to get into some grace here. And it seems like to me that that's a bad thing in the Pentecostal church is grace. Because it seems like to me that for the many years that I've listened that it's more hellfire and damnation, God's going to get you than God loves me. God loves me. God loves you. But, right? Uh-huh. Well, people need to get their butt out of this deal because there ain't no but. God loves you. Okay. Galatians chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. Going to get better. Oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? That's an interesting word. We'll talk about it. That you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed among you as crucified. This only I want to learn from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now being made perfect by the flesh? Have you suffered so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Just as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness, therefore know that only those who are of faith are the sons of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, in you all nations shall be blessed. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. The Bible says Abraham believed God, and it was righteousness was imputed to him simply because he believed God. Before the law of circumcision was made, before the law was even given, without any works, simply because he believed God, it was counted unto him as righteousness. Do I have any believers in here this morning? Come on, somebody. Glory to God. O foolish Galatians, verse 1, who has bewitched you? That word bewitched means cast a spell on. Yeah, that's what it means. It means who has cast a spell on you? How many know the devil does stuff like that? And for people who are willing to walk into whatever bait he lays out there, they're open to get whatever he's got. That's why we have to be on the guard. constantly. Not that we got to run around being scared of the devil, but make sure we're not deceived with our doctrine. Okay? But verse 3, I think, is the key verse. He says, are you so foolish, having begun in the spirit, are you now being made perfect by the flesh? Here's where the rubber meets the road right here, folks. Here I'm going to give you, this is not me speaking, okay? This is not what I believe. This is what I have been taught over the years through the Pentecostal church. I'm going to read it to you, and you can make your decision on it. Goes something like this. God forgives you of all your sins when you get saved and you are a child of God. Is that true? Yeah. That's good. But, here it is. But, from here on out, you must confess and repent of every sin you commit or you will go to hell when you die because you missed one or because you died before you got a chance to repent of the last one you committed. Yeah. I was taught that. Some of you may say, well, yeah, that's true. It's not true. Some of you are laughing because you're thinking that's ridiculous. Yes, it is ridiculous. I had a pastor tell me one time, he said, if I'm standing on the street corner and I have a lustful thought go through my mind, and I step out in front of a bus and it runs over me before I have a chance to repent, I will go to hell. Wonder why my girls don't go to church. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Grace. Where's the grace? Okay. So from here on out, you must confess and repent of every sin or you will go to hell when you die because you missed one or died before you got a chance to repent of it. Therefore, my salvation no longer rests on Christ and His payment for my sin, but my salvation rests on my ability to repent. I guess Jesus' blood ain't strong enough. He had to turn it back over to me. I got news for you. I can't save me. I can't keep me justified. I can't, turn to Romans chapter 4. I want to show you a few things. You're going to think I'm Baptist by the time I'm done. But I can't do nothing but preach the truth from the way I see it from this word. And I'm sorry. Do I believe in eternal security? No. Do I believe that a man can lose his salvation? Yes, I do. But I don't think it's that easy. Chapter 4, verse 8. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. Let's have a grammar lesson. Or will not impute sin. Blessed is the man who the Lord will not impute sin. Will not. Is that past tense? Is it present tense? Or is it future tense? Future? It's future tense. He will not. I will go to the store. I haven't went yet, but I will go. That's what? It's future tense. Future tense. He will not impute sin. That is future tense right there. Okay. Look at Hebrews, the book of Hebrews with me. Chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9. And we're going to look at verse 12. God only forgave my past sins. He don't have nothing to do with the ones that are happening right now or the ones that are going to happen in the future. Yeah. We'll see. Verse 12. Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. How long is eternal? It's a long time, ain't it? Yeah. Is it like forever or something like that? Yeah. He entered one time to gain eternal redemption. Look at verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Verse 15. And for this reason, he is the mediator of the new covenant by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. How long is eternal? Okay. Look at verse 26. He then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, once, at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Verse 28. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time apart from sin to salvation. He entered one time to gain our eternal redemption. He suffered one time. Turn over to chapter 10. Look at verse 10. By that we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. How often? Jesus only died one time, and he died for all, forever, one time. Look at verse 14. For by one offering he has perfected those who are being sanctified. He has forever, perfected forever those who are being sanctified. How long is forever? He said he has perfected you forever. I hadn't planned on going here, but I just feel like I need to. There are different levels your sanctification works on. Okay? Ralph mentioned a scripture Wednesday night that I had to go study, and it's Hebrews Chapter 10, I believe it was, maybe it wasn't chapter 10. The scripture was that without holiness, no man will see God. So we have to be holy. But how holy do we have to be? That's my question. And who decides how holy you have to be? And is it the same standard for everybody? Okay, the word holiness there don't mean holiness. Exactly, it means sanctification. It's translated 10 times in the New Testament. 5 times it's used as holiness, 5 times it's used as sanctification. Sanctification is being set apart for God, right? Sanctification works in two ways. It's instantaneous and it's progressive. I am instantaneously sanctified before God when I am born again. My sins are washed away. How many, when you were born again, okay, we're talking about in the spirit and then in the flesh or in the body. How many in your body, when you got born again, were perfect from that day forward? How many of you left the church or wherever it was that you got saved at and you were perfect? But were your sins forgiven? Yes. They're washed away as far as the east is from the west, positionally. So there is a positional sanctification and there is a practical sanctification. Positionally, the Bible says, I am seated with Christ in heavenly places, on his throne with him. Positionally, because of his blood. But practically, I'm right here today. So, positionally, my sins are washed away. And I am pure and holy before God. My spirit is born again. It is sealed into the day of redemption. And the devil can't touch it. Although practically, I'm having some problems and some issues. Amen? Okay. Jesus suffered one time to gain your eternal salvation. He never has to suffer again. Past, present, and future is covered in the redemption. That may be hard for some, but it's true. The blood of Jesus was sufficient. It was sufficient to wash me and cleanse me of all my sin. Not only to wash me and cleanse me of all my sin, but to keep me now and tomorrow. I don't have to walk around worrying about, did I mess up and sin and am I going to go to hell now? No, I don't. I am born again. I'm sealed to the day of redemption. I don't have to walk around in fear. I don't have to walk around in condemnation. But I can walk around in the love of Jesus. Is grace a license to sin? What did Paul say? God forbid. They asked the question, should we continue in sin that grace may abound? He said, God forbid. No. A little more on that, a little farther down. Romans chapter 14. I want to show you a few more things. I told you we'd get back to some things a little earlier. This is one of them. Romans 14, 23. Talking about eating meat sacrificed to idols and stuff here. But it's the principle of what he's saying that I want to make known to you here. But he who doubts is condemned if he eats, because he does not eat from faith. Now here's the line that's important. This applies to everything. For whatever is not from faith is sin. Did y'all hear that? Whatever is not from faith is sin. How many of you have ever operated not in faith? Well, it was sin. Did you repent of it? Did you repent of not operating in faith? Every time you done it? Well, how are you going to get in heaven then? You have a sin that's unconfessed. How are you going to get in heaven? You're going to get in heaven by the blood of Jesus. Because your sins are paid for. That's how you're going to get in heaven. Okay? Go with me to James chapter 4, verse 17. This could be a shouting message. If somebody was glad they're saved, hallelujah. 4:17. If somebody was glad for the grace of God that set them free, hallelujah. James 4:17. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. How many have ever not done the right thing when you're supposed to? And how many have repented of it every single time that it happened? You think you ever might have missed one? You ever think you might have never done something that wasn't right or something you should have done? Bible says it's sin. Did you repent of it? Well, if you didn't, then you got unconfessed sin in your life. You're going to hell. That's what I've been taught. But you know what? I don't think so. The blood of Jesus is enough to forgive my sin if I messed up and forgot to repent of it. Now, losing your salvation, we don't have time to go into all that. I can tell you how I believe all that works. And it don't work by simply forgetting or overlooking or maybe even not even really conscious of sinning and not repenting of it. So there are two scriptures that show us that it's almost impossible to keep account of everything you've done wrong and repent of all of it. And ain't nothing but a Pharisaical spirit that says they have. They're wrong. They've missed it too. And if I'm going to hell, they're going to be right there with me. Because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. None is righteous, no, not one. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, remember that gift, is eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. I have the gift of God. Am I giving you a license to sin? No, that's not what I'm talking about. But I'm talking about when you're born again, when you're truly born again, you are going to be convicted of sin. And when you commit sins, you're going to feel wrong and you're going to repent of those things. But my ability to repent of my sins has nothing to do with my salvation. It's done. It's sealed. I mean, that may sound like heresy to some of you, but I've been studying this and I've been looking at this for a long time. And I've been figuring out what's being preached and what's not being preached. So you think you've repented of every sin. I'm going to say you missed one somewhere. And if you think you have, you're a Pharisee. Look at Galatians chapter 5. We're about done, folks. Galatians chapter 5. Only got two more scriptures. 5 verse 4. You have become estranged from Christ, you who attempt to be justified by the law, you have fallen from grace. What we talk about in the first of this message, we talked about how they were going after another gospel, not a gospel of grace, but a gospel of works. He said right here in this scripture in verse 4 that if you are trying to be justified before God any other way than faith in Jesus, that you are fallen from grace. That you have abandoned grace and that you have went after another gospel. The only way I can be justified is through faith in Jesus Christ alone. I cannot be justified before God because of my good works, because of my good deeds, because of my good looks. No, I mean, you can't be justified before God in no other way. What about my righteousness? Well, your righteousness are as filthy rags, Isaiah said. But he has made him to be sin who knew no sin, that I might be made the righteousness of God in him. So if it meant that I got justified by my righteousness, I'd never get there. I'm justified by his righteousness. Can y'all hear what I'm saying this morning? God has justified you freely, the Word of God says. He, by his grace, upholds you. And that should make you just want to fall on your knees and say, thank you, Jesus. That should make you not want to sin because a God that loves you so much that he gave himself for you to freely redeem you and make you in right relationship with God. That's what happened in the beginning. That's what happened right now. And that's what's going to happen tomorrow. I'm going to be justified by his grace in all three tenses. Amen? Okay. Last scripture, in closing, Titus. Go to the book of Titus. Titus is right before Hebrews, I believe. The last of the Pauline epistles. No, it's not either. Philemon is the last one. Okay, so Titus is right before Philemon, which is right before Hebrews. Philemon, no, Titus. Titus chapter 2. Look at Titus chapter 2, and we're going to look at 11 through 15. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. Speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority, and let nobody despise you. The grace of God that brings salvation has appeared unto all men, and the grace of God teaches us that we should deny ungodliness and worldly lust, and that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly. The grace of God does what? It teaches us. It doesn't condemn us. It doesn't demand perfection like the Jewish law. But it teaches us. Somebody needs to be taught ain't there yet, are they? Somebody that needs to be taught is not the teacher. Somebody that needs to be taught is a student. We're all students. And we learn as we go along. Practical sanctification. Growing in God and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He is in a process of teaching us in this body. Well, Tommy, what good's all that? I thought he wanted us to be just like Jesus. Yes, he does. But he don't want us to be just like Jesus in this body so that we can get to heaven. That's already the done deal. He wants us to be like Jesus in this body that we will be a prophet to the body of Christ. He wants us to be like Jesus in this body so that we will be ambassadors of Jesus. So that people will look at us and say, that's what it means. That's what grace is all about. He wants us to be like Jesus so we can preach and we can teach and we can love and we can feed and we can clothe people and we can help people and we can be his hands and feet. That's why he wants us to be like Jesus. That's why he's teaching us to deny ungodliness so that we can be like him for our own profit. Not for his. It's for our own profit. He knows that if we get tangled up in the wrong stuff, that we are no earthly good. And he knows that even in our personal lives, we walk around with guilt, shame, and condemnation, and we don't feel good about ourselves. Now, I don't preach a self-help gospel by no means, but this is what the grace of God does. It teaches us. And it teaches us to deny these things, ungodliness, worldly lust, that we should live soberly and righteously and godly. What grace? What grace? Is that awesome grace or what? Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, as I come to you right now, I thank you for this congregation of people, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for their love and their support, God. And I know that you love them with an everlasting love. But God, I pray right now that if for those here that have had to walk under a heavy, heavy load of condemnation because they didn't feel like they could ever make the mark or they weren't good enough, Lord, witness to their hearts right now that Jesus was good enough in their place. That's why he came. He came to make up the difference. Is there somebody here this morning that would lift a hand and say, Brother Tommy, I've been under condemnation, thinking I couldn't make the grade or I wasn't good enough. Would you pray for me? I'm not going to embarrass nobody. I'm not going to call nobody at the altar. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. He sees those hands. There are those here that have been in a combination because they don't think that they can be good enough. Are there those here this morning that was their brother Tommy? I don't even know this Jesus you're talking about. And I don't know if I died today, I'd go be with him or not. Is that you? Would you like me to pray for you? Slip a hand up. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray right now for those who have been under the condemnation of the enemy because they didn't feel like they could measure up, that God, that you would restore their joy. Hallelujah. Your word says that in your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. God, I pray that you'll restore the joy of their salvation to them, God, and make them realize that you have made the difference.